Good morning, class. Welcome to Surgery and Sage Connection. Today we are going to look at the general preoperative care of a patient who is going to undergo surgery. I'm Mrs. Daka, and this lesson, I've named it Lesson 4. It has Part 1, Part 2, and Part 3. I've divided it into this way so that you understand, because everything in part one up to part three, they are all talking about the general preoperative care. Let's move on. The general objective that we have is that you should understand and be able to define the surgical terminologies and be able to define the pre and intra-operative nursing care, and describe also the nursing activities that are done in the pre and intra-operative phases. As a nurse, you should understand that surgery is a busy and demanding area of the hospital. And management of patients in the surgical ward is very important. Each surgical client or each surgical patient presents and responds differently to surgery, because each patient has the self-care abilities that usually compromise during the administration of anesthesia in theater. So as a nurse, you should be able to meet and identify the needs of the patient. You should be able to understand the history, the physical assessment, the pathophysiology, the lab tests that are done during preoperative care, and the nature of the procedure or the surgery that is going to be done. And finally, you also need to understand the complications that may arise because of the operation that the patient has gone through. So as you think of working in a surgical ward, as a nurse, you should be vigilant. You should be able to stand the challenges. For the definitions, the preoperative care is just simply the care that is given to a client before, during, and after surgery. This is perioperative care. Perioperative care encompasses all the three phases: pre, during, and after surgery. Whilst preoperative care is the physiological and psychological preparation of a patient before they can undergo any operation. What are the aims for preoperative care? The first aim is we want to prepare this patient physically. And we want to ensure that this patient is physically fit and has good mental condition so that as they undergo surgery, they will be able to withstand it. The other aim is that we want to treat and to control any existing condition that is available before surgery. Meaning, for example, if a patient has hypertension or is diabetic, we need to control that disease before the patient can undergo surgery. If it is a disease that is treatable, like pneumonia, the patient should be treated and should be free from that disease before they can undergo surgery. Then the third aim that we have in preoperative care is that we want to eliminate or to minimize the complications that may occur during or after the operation, because as the patient undergoes the operation, you discover a lot of complications may arise. So we want to eliminate them or minimize them so that they don't actually appear after the operation. Therefore, the preoperative care can be divided into three phases. There's what we call remote. Sometimes you find others calling it usual, or the most common word that is used is elective preoperative care. Then the second part is what we call immediate preoperative care. That is the care that is given within the last 12 hours before the patient can undergo the surgery. Then the last part is what we call emergency preoperative care. So in all this, I'll explain what you are supposed to do as a nurse in elective preoperative care, in immediate preoperative care, and in an emergency preoperative care. Let's move on. So when you are preparing a patient for an operation, the nursing care that you are going to give should be organized and it should be well tabulated. And because of that need to organize your nursing care, there are two ways that we use to organize our nursing care. The first one is where we use the word or the abbreviation apophrenema, so that it helps you remember how to organize your work. We'll talk about this in detail later on. The other way is you can organize your nursing care using two titles or two subtitles, the psychological care and the physical care. Let's look at one of these before, as we go down to organize our nursing care. So in this preoperative care, let's start with the two main components of the preoperative nursing care that you are going to give, where you give the two titles, the psychological preparation and the physical preparation. So let's look at the psychological preparation, and therefore we'll later on look at the physical preparation on how we are organizing our nursing care for this patient. So for the psychological care, as you attend to this patient has come into the ward, they are admitted and they are waiting to go for surgery. You need to take note of their psychological status, meaning what is going on in the mind of this patient as they think of surgery, as they think of this operation. So you have to prepare your patient mentally or psychologically in order for you to allay anxiety. You should take care of the concerns, the fears that the patient is having. As you know, our concerns and our fears are different as we meet different people. Some people are more anxious, some people are afraid, they are even afraid of pain, they are afraid of the discomfort, they are thinking of what will happen after the surgery. Others also, they may even fear about being disfigured. How will they look like if this part of the body is removed, or if this part of the body is operated on, what is going to happen? So you are going to allow this patient to pour out their fear, pour out their concerns. Sometimes the patient may also be afraid of dying, you should be able to address this, because you cannot just allow the patient to go with that kind of fear. They don't know what will be the outcome of the operation. So whether their fears are known, or whether their fears are not known, you should be able to address this problem. The other thing that you should look at in the psychological preparation of this patient is the patient's emotions. When the emotions of the patient are evoked, you discover that there will be a physiological response. So, which this physiological response may have unfavorable effect on the patient's recovery after the operation. So, the patient who is emotionally disturbed should be able to be helped to overcome their emotions. And how will you know that this patient is having emotional problems? They will have difficulty in passing urine, or they will suddenly begin to vomit, or they will suddenly become very restless as they prepare to go for surgery. The other thing that you need to do in the psychological preparation, you need to assess the patient's concerns and the patient's perception of surgery, meaning what is this the patient thinking about the operation? What is going on in the mind of this patient as they think of this operation? So you should be able to assess the level of stress as they think of this. You should also be able to assess the level of anxiety. You can only do this by observing the behavior of the patient. If the patient is stressed, if the patient is anxious, you discover that the patient is very hypersensitive. For talkative patients, you discover that the patient is talking more. And sometimes the patient will keep asking you the same questions. You answer the question, later on they will keep asking the same question on and on and on and off, on and off. For some patients, they will just be crying. And this, for some patients, they will be withdrawn. They don't want to interact with any other person, or they don't want to be near any other person. For some patients, they will develop insomnia. They will fail to sleep because of the anxiety states. They will fail to sleep because of the stress that they are going through because of the thought of going for an operation. The other thing that we look at in the preparation or the psychological preparation of this patient is that a stressed patient who have increased heart rate and increased respiratory rate. So they'll be breathing faster, and when you check the pulse is very high. When you check the blood pressure, their blood pressure is high. For some patients, as the anxiety continues to grow, they will discover that the palms of the patient or the feet of the patient begins to be moist, and then they will become restless. So for this patient, you need to encourage the patient so that you review their fears, you review their concerns, and you should be able to show that you understand their fears, you understand their concerns, and you should be able to accept as a nurse that these emotions are real for this patient. And because of that, you are already expecting them, you should be able to give information to this patient so that this proper information, correct information, will help alleviate the anxiety and the fears of the patient. Let's move on. The other thing in the psychological preparation for this patient is you should be able to anticipate the change in the body appearance and be able to explain and advise the patient of the available assistance and how he can manage his life after surgery. So what you need to do is you need to encourage this patient to see and to talk to other patients who have had a similar successful operation. Sometimes the anesthetist may be able to come over a night before the day of operation to visit and to explain to the patient what the patient is expecting in theater. Sometimes also the surgeon will be able to explain to the patient how they can overcome this fear and what is expected of them just after surgery or as they think of the operation. The family members also need to be informed, and you should be able as a nurse to take time to inform them what is going on, to inform them, also answer their questions, answer their concerns, so that they'll be able to sit with the patient and be able to explain and discuss what is going on, so that the fears and the concerns of both the patient and the relatives are taken care of. The other thing that needs to be done in the psychological preparation is that the consent form should be signed. A consent form is a form which we give to the patient to sign, so that it gives the hospital staff the authority to carry out an operation on this patient. So the patient should have enough information, correct information on the kind of surgery that they are going to go through, so that they'll be able to sign and authorize the medical staff to do an operation on them. And you as a nurse, your job is to make sure that you countersign as a witness on this consent form. So as you ask the patient to sign the consent form and you sign as a witness, you should be able to know that this patient should be above 18 years and is conscious. If the patient is not above 18 years, should find a next of kin, a relative to this patient who can sign on their behalf. And if the patient is unconscious and is unable or is mentally ill but needs surgery, you need to find the next of kin to sign the consent form for them. But in cases where it is an emergency, you discover that even the chief medical superintendent can sign on behalf of the patient for the patient to undergo surgery. So when this consent form is signed, it will remain valid for 2 weeks, and then the patient, within 2 weeks, the patient can go for surgery. And this is only done during elective surgery. Let's move on. Let's look at the physical preparation. The physical preparation has other smaller titles that you'll be able to look at. So we'll start with the patient teaching. As you prepare this patient for surgery, you need to teach this patient how to deep breathe and how to do limb exercises in order to increase the oxygen saturation and in order to prevent the post-operative pulmonary complications. Patients who don't do deep breathing exercises or exercises of the limbs, you discover that they will have complications that may arise post-operatively because the air within the body, within the lungs, has not been enough. So encourage your patient to do deep breathing exercises, encourage your patient to do coughing exercises so that you be able to increase the oxygen saturation in the body. If the patient is expected to have an operation on the abdominal cavity or on the chest, preoperatively you should be able to encourage the patient or teach the patient how to cough while they support the abdomen. The patient should be able to hold the muscles of the abdomen and cough. This is going to help the patient to do this even post-operatively and to help prevent the pulmonary complications. The other thing that you need to do also is the coughing exercises that should be done preoperatively and postoperatively. The coughing exercises helps the patient to learn to remove the sputum before they can accumulate, so that this sputum should not accumulate within the lungs. So the other thing is that if the patient is smoking or is a smoker, this patient should be told to stop smoking preoperatively so that you prevent the smoke from irritating the respiratory system, which may predispose the respiratory system to infection. So make sure the patient should temporarily stop smoking while they prepare to go for surgery. The other thing that we do in the patient care is that the exercises, the limbs, the lower limb exercises or the upper limb exercises should be done so that we prevent thrombosis or embolism. So the patient should be involved, should be informed about how to go back out of bed early, how should be able to sit in the chair, how is the patient is supposed to be walking around the room after the operation, so that the muscles are given an opportunity to stretch and not allow stasis of blood in the muscles, in the veins, that may make the blood to begin to clot and form a thrombi or an emboli. So you teach the patient also, in case you are expecting the drainage tubes to be present post-operatively, teach the patient how to handle these drainage tubes, and also explain how to the pain will be cared for or will be controlled after the operation. The patient will not be allowed to be in pain for such a long time, but medication will be given so that pain is controlled. The other thing that we talk about in the physical preparation of this patient that we are preparing for surgery is that the patient is given a physical examination. And during this examination, we'll do the vital signs and we are going to compare them later on after surgery so that we see how the patient is faring. We are also going to do the laboratory tests that may include urinalysis, the HB count, the hematocrit, the bleeding time and clotting time. The patient may go for electrocardiography. The patient may go for chest X-ray, and we are also going to get blood sugar so that we test and rule out diabetes mellitus. For the nutritional status of this patient, as we prepare this patient to undergo surgery, the patient who is well nourished will be able to tolerate surgery well, while the patient who is not well nourished they will fail to tolerate surgery. So it will be a challenge. So if the patient is not well nourished, the protein that should be given to this patient so that you boost and increase their protein levels so that wound healing can occur later on postoperatively without difficulty. The protein also will also help the patient to fight infection as they undergo the operation. Vitamin C and vitamin B and B complex, all these should be included in the diet of the patient so that the patient will have an optimum nutritional levels as they go for operation. A patient who has deficiency in carbohydrates, it is very difficult for this patient to withstand the preoperative care, because there will be a time when the patient will need to starve, and it will be difficult for this patient to release the glycogen levels that are needed during the preoperative care as the patient prepares for surgery. So make sure you give carbohydrates to the patient so that the patient can have a boosted glycogen level. If the patient is able to tolerate the carbohydrate levels, you should give a high calorie diet and vitamin supplements so that the appetite of this patient is boosted and the patient can eat as much as possible. But if the patient is not able to eat, make sure that you give intravenous fluids so that during the time the patient is near orally, the intravenous fluids will be able to help to increase the carbohydrate levels. Let's move on. A patient also who is dehydrated and is having an electrolyte imbalance, it is very difficult for them to undergo surgery, to withstand surgery, that is what I mean. When they go for surgery, they are likely to develop shock. So you need to replace the fluids, you need to correct the electrolyte imbalance so that the patient is well hydrated and will be able to have these fluids in the correct volume so that the patient will be able to withstand the surgery as they bleed in theater. You should also be able to weigh the patient. You should also be able to check if the patient is having any dental caries, that is dental, the tooth decays, so that these conditions are treated and it will help in the level of the of preparation for the patient to go for surgery. So as we have done all this, we've come to the immediate preparation for this patient. Now we are preparing for this patient to undergo surgery for between 6 to 12 hours just before the operation. So what we are going to do for this patient is we'll make sure that within these 6 to 12 hours, the patient's stomach is empty, and as the patient is going to theater, the patient should not go with a full stomach, but the patient should have an empty stomach so that we prevent vomiting. And as the patient may vomit while they are unconscious, the patient may aspirate their own vomitus and may die while having an operation. So all food should be withdrawn, and within 4 to 6 hours before the scheduled time for operation, the patient should be new already, should have nothing to eat. Nothing should be put in the mouth. That is what we mean by new orally. So this information should be given to the patient so that the patient should not eat anything privately. Let's move on. The patient is also given oral medication with some little water. A small amount of water is what we are going to use, and make sure as you give this patient, the medication is given at the correct time so that you don't compromise the new orary position that the patient needs to have before we can have the operation. In this period, the patient should also be able to empty their bowels before they can go for operation. So if the patient has failed to open their bowels, what you need to do is you need to give an enema. The surgeon who is doing this surgery, if it is surgery that may affect the intestines, they will prescribe what kind of enema you are going to give. Remember, the enema, there is the soapy enema, there is the antibacterial enemas that you may give, and you should be able to consult with the surgeon which type of enema you are going to give to this patient. Let's move on. The other part that you should be able to consider during elimination is the urinary bladder. The patient should go to empty the bladder before they can go for operation. And if they are not able to empty the bladder, you need to insert a catheter on the patient so that the urine comes out and make sure that the bladder is empty. So sometimes the catheter can be put there, and then where you remove the urine and remove it, or you put in what we call an indwelling catheter, where you leave the catheter there and the patient will go to theater with a catheter inside. So this is what is expected of you, and make sure the bowels are emptied and the bladder is also emptied. No patient should go to theater with a full bladder or with the bowels that are not empty. Let's move on to the local site preparation, meaning on the area where they are going to operate from, you should prepare this patient, meaning you should shave the skin of the patient from the nipple line to the mid thigh for all patients who are going to undergo abdominal surgery. If the operation is not on the abdominal area, the specific area where the operation will take place will be indicated, and you should be able to shave this patient. Make sure when you are shaving this patient, you don't make cuts. The skin should continue to be intact. It should have no cracks. It should not have any cuts. But you should be able to shave this patient without cutting them anywhere. If it is the operation that will involve the skull or the scalp on the head, you should be able to shave the whole head so that the patient is ready for the operation. If the patient is having an operation on the breast, make sure you shave the shoulder, the arm, or and up to the elbow, depending on how much hair the patient is having on the area where they are going to be operated from. Let's move on. If the patient is having what we call hernia, which means a protrusion somewhere on the abdomen, then you need to shave even that area where the hernia is coming from. And it depends on wherever the patient is having the operation from, that area should be shaved. No hair should be remained unless the surgeon indicates that they don't want any hair to be removed. Then you cannot shave the patient. Let's move on. The other thing that you need to do for this patient in the 6 to 12 hours before the scheduled time for operation, the patient is supposed to have a bath. Or you can ask the patient to go for a shower. Or if the patient is not able to walk, then you should do a bed bath in the morning of the surgery. And you should be able to, after the patient has bathed, you should be able to give the patient a clean hospital gown. Make sure the patient's mouth, the teeth are cleaned before they can go for surgery. So do oral care, do the bed bath or the shower for the patient, and make sure the patient is generally clean. Include the nails of the patient. You also need to include the care for the mouth. For example, if the patient is having dentures, dentures are artificial teeth. So you need to remove the artificial teeth for the patient, get them and put them in a glass of water and leave them on the side of the patient. Make sure you also remove all the jewelry on the patient, and you need to keep them safe. If the patient is having a wedding ring and they don't want that wedding ring to be removed, you need to get a strapping and wrap it around so that the patient is not electrocuted during the operation in case they use the diathermy machine. The hair of this patient should be combed and it should be tied, but you should not use any hair pins, and you should make sure the patient has no nail polish, no lipstick, so that it helps you to see whether the patient is going into cyanosis or not. So make sure all these things are done before the patient can go for an operation. Let's move on. The patient should be identified. Remember, as the patient goes to theater, they will be given the anesthesia and they may sleep. So there will be no one to ask, who is this patient, what is the name of the patient, where is the patient coming from. So it is your duty as a nurse to give an identity band or bracelet. Or if you don't have the bracelets, you can get strapping and write the name, the sex, the age, the date, the diagnosis, and the procedures to be done. Write it on a strapping and strap it on the forehead of the patient. The other thing that needs to be done is the pre-medication that is supposed to be given. There are times when the surgeon will ask the patient to have a pre-medication for this patient. It may be a sedative, it may be a drug that may help patient have a sleep, a good sleep before the operation, or it may be a drug that will help to dry the secretions of the patient as they prepare to go for surgery. Then the other thing that you need to do is, as the patient is nearing to go to theater, collect all the laboratory results, the x-ray films, the doctors and the nurses' notes, and put everything that you have done on the patient, put them together, and they should go with the patient to the operating theater. Let's move on. Finally, this patient has to be transferred from the ward to the operating theater. And as you carry all these files, all the information of the patient, you need to put the patient on the stretcher and then wheel the patient to theater. How do you wheel the patient to theater? Make sure as a nurse you stand on the head of the patient so that you'll be able to observe the patient as you transport the patient to theater, while the other person, who is called a porter, is on the side of the legs for the patient, and the porter is in front of you, while as a nurse you should be behind, and you wheel the stretcher to where the patient is, and you keep talking to the patient, continue giving the psychological care. Make sure you cover this patient as you move the patient from the ward to the operating theater so that the patient is warm enough. And as you arrive into the operating theater, you'll be able to find a nurse, a theater nurse there, and you should be able to introduce yourself and introduce your patient, and then hand over to the theater nurse the patient, and assure the patient that they are in safe hands, they will be able to be cared for, and assure the patient that you will be able to go back to theater to collect the patient. So as you come back from theater, you have handed over your patient into theater, you should be able to come back to the ward and make a post-operative bed, anticipating that your patient will soon be returning and will need to be cared for. So on that post-operative bed, make sure you put all the bed accessories that you may need. For example, you may need a suction machine, you need the oxygen cylinder, or you need the drip stand, you need the TPR tray, the airways, you need the needles and syringes, you need the IV fluids, you need the emergency drugs. All these things should be put in place so that as the patient comes back, you are able to help the patient and deal with any emergencies that may arise as the patient comes back from theater. This post-operative bed should be made near the nurse's table in the emergency bay. So thank you very much. We've come to the end of this lesson. This is the lesson 4, part 1. So we'll continue in part 2 to look at the other way of doing the organizing the nursing care for the patient who is preparing to go for surgery. Thank you so much. Meet you in the next lesson. Bye.